I should have given you time to ask questions, but I will not, because there's an important part of the scripture, of the passage, and it's very important for us to understand what the Word of God teaches and how the believer is to respond whenever we have challenges that human understanding cannot solve. A teacher in the adult section spoke about the wisdom of Rahab. He applied that wisdom of Rahab to wanting to get saved, which is right, which is true. And so she had a covenant with the people, the spies, and then eventually got saved, and she stopped there. In the youth section, the teacher was forthright and clear. The teacher emphasized in the youth section that God knows how to protect his people, and that God did not need the lie or deception of Rahab to protect the spies. In that way, in the youth section, they cleared it up. You understand that God is mighty. Actually, when you look at Joshua chapter 6, don't open, I'll just tell you, you know the story already, that in taking Jericho, which is the city we're studying about, they had to shoot anything, drive anything, dig anything. They just walked around, and then eventually the walls came down flat. And they didn't save Rahab. All the other walls fell down, but by God's mighty power, he preserved the wall on which the house of Rahab was. And so you see the divine orchestration of the whole thing. And then if you think about the young prophet that Rehoboam said, take him. He wanted to take him, his hand dried up. He couldn't pull the hand back. God has power to be able to do whatever he wants to do. And then you remember 185,000 soldiers of Sennacherib. How God sent one angel and destroyed all of them in one night. And God could have done any of those things, remember Joshua, on the battlefield. How the sun was touched and the moon was touched. God could perform a miracle like that. And then you remember how Daniel was thrown into the lion's den, and the lions couldn't touch them. And then you remember Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, how they were in the furnace of fire, and the fire could not burn them. So, we understand that God can protect his people without having to go into what the people of the world do. And even though our teacher in the adult section mentioned the wisdom of Rahab, and he applied the wisdom to seeking salvation, the minds of the hearers will generally go back to a lie and count that as wisdom. And we're planning business, we're trying to move forward, we're, you know, trying to get this and get this in life. And when you remember the lies of Rahab and the wisdom of Rahab too, then you're likely to say, I can manage myself this way and that way and do this and do that. After all, Rahab was saved. Of course she was saved. And so I can do this. But ask yourself, what saved Rahab? If you look at the New Testament, it says by faith Rahab was saved, not by the lie. If you look at James, it says God honored the work that he did, that she did. That is the work of faith, because faith without works is dead. And then James did not refer to the lie, it referred to the protection. You see, God looked at Rahab as a Gentile, an Amorite. And because she was an Amorite, that's what she knew. She had no Bible. She had never read the Ten Commandments. She didn't have the law. She didn't have a church. She didn't have the system of the religious training upbringing of the Israelites. She didn't have any teaching. She didn't have any book of righteousness. She didn't have any law. She was without God, without law, and without the covenant and the commonwealth of Israel. And in her own sinfulness, as well as in her own gentle behavior, and in her own lifestyle, all she knew to protect these people, that was before her salvation. And so you cannot use that, if you are now a believer, and see what Rahab did before salvation, and then continue to do that after salvation. You have the Bible now, you have Genesis, Revelation, and so you cannot say the wisdom of Rahab is going to be your own wisdom, and then you're going to tell lies, and then you understand that in the case of Rahab, understand, Rahab was changing allegiance. Rahab was under the king of Jericho, but now she was coming out of that allegiance, and she was going to give her loyalty and allegiance to Israel. And so you will see that she didn't any lie to the spies, because she said, I'm going to be loyal to you. I'm responsible to you now. My allegiance is to you now. But she felt in her own gentle behavior, she could lie to the king, because I'm not under you anymore. I'm already going to plant my lot with the people of Israel. And so now, come back to this. If your allegiance is to your husband, you cannot say I'm copying Rahab and tell lies to your husband. If your allegiance is to your wife, you cannot, you know, tell lies to your wife and say I'm using the wisdom of Rahab, because now your allegiance is now to your wife, to your husband. If your allegiance is to Christ, you cannot tell him lies. If your allegiance is to your pastor in the church, you cannot say this is Rahab. You see, Rahab, she understood what she was doing. Her allegiance was no more to the king of Jericho. And she said, I have nothing to do with you anymore. I'm putting my lot with the people of Israel. And she didn't tell any lies to the people she had allegiance to. Not only that, Rahab told a lie before salvation. And then some people use that as excuse to tell lies after salvation. Not only that, Rahab told one lie, only one lie recorded in her lifetime before salvation. And then there are people that tell lies. They tell one lie in a month, that's 12, maybe one lie in a week, and that's 50, more than 50 in a year. And then, you know, they go through that all their lives, and they say, I'm following Rahab. You're not following Rahab. She told really one lie in her gentle condition. Then you now continue that and multiply that. You make yours a habit. And in the case of Rahab, not at all. I'm going to, you know, think about the wisdom of Rahab now, which is the wisdom of the world, really. Because if you look at 1 Corinthians chapter 1, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 21. For after that, in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God. The world by their wisdom knew not God. There are many kinds of wisdom, and the wisdom of Rahab in telling the lie and protecting those spies is the wisdom of the world before she came to know the Lord. And by wisdom she knew not God. It wasn't that kind of carnal wisdom, worldly wisdom that made her to be saved. It was her faith. By faith Rahab got saved. That's Hebrews 11, verse 31. And then you look at chapter 2 of 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 6. Howbeit we speak wisdom among them that are perfect, yet not the wisdom of this world. That's the wisdom of the world. And if you are not of the world anymore, you are born again, you are not like Rahab before salvation. You cannot have that kind of wisdom, because it says over here, yet the wisdom, not the wisdom of this world, and not of the princes of the world that come to naught in your business transactions. If you cover up on your taxes, if you cover up on your returns, If you cover up on your negotiations with people, even with the church, when maybe the church is buying something through your company, then you tell your boys or, you know, your workers, officers there, do it this way, do it this way, do it this way, and then one of the people will challenge you, how can we do that? Oh, then you say, let's be wise. If you are not wise, you're not going to make it in life. So let's be wise. That's the wisdom of the world. And that, the one that leads us to lying, to deception, actually is going to land us in hell. But looking at verse 13, chapter 2, verse 13, which things also we speak, not in the words which man's wisdom teaches. It says, we who are now preachers, we who are pastors and apostles, and we who are leaders in the church, we speak, but we don't speak in the words which man's wisdom teaches. It says, it goes on there in that verse 13, but which the Holy Ghost teaches, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. Let's go look at James. In James, we're looking at chapter 3. Verse 15, James chapter 3, reading from verse 15, this wisdom descended not from above. You see, there is a wisdom from beneath, a wisdom from the pit, a wisdom from the Gentile nations, a wisdom from the kind of, literature books we have read in the past, a kind of wisdom that we get from the villages, the kind of wisdom we get from all the people that are clever and crafty and able to deceive. And you're not no head from tail, and then you get into trouble, and they get into trouble too. This wisdom descended not from above, but is earthly, sensual, devilish. It says in verse 17, but the wisdom which is from above is first pure and truthful. And it says, then peaceable and gentle is it to be treated, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. The wisdom from above does not have hypocrisy in it. And so let's come back to Joshua. I'm looking at Joshua chapter 2. Joshua chapter 2. Now that we understand that the wisdom of the world is not going to help us spiritually, aren't you? Now look at Joshua chapter 2, verse 1. And Joshua the son of Nun sent out of Shittim two men to spy secretly, saying, go, view the land, even Jericho. And they went and came into an harlot's house named Rahab and lodged there. The question is, why should good people, righteous people, Israelites, dependable, trustworthy people, go into a harlot's house? They didn't go there to mess up their lives. They knew that that's where they normally come. Everybody comes there. Well, everybody of their own kind of people. And if you're going to have information, that's where you have free flow of free information. That's where you can eavesdrop and hear what this one is saying, what that one is saying. And they went to examine the land. And we're going to have all the information needed about the country where you have loose talk, free talking, and on strange speech. That's where they went. That's the reason they went there to start with. And they were told in verse 2, and it was told the king of Jericho, saying, behold, there came men in hither tonight of the children of Israel to search out the country. Well, it shows that those people that were going to search it, even though they had free talk and free conversation and all that there, they were vigilant too. And somebody out of that place saw those two spies, and they immediately reported to the king, look at our country at this time, and look at the situation of security and insecurity that we face. And sometimes you might know that, you know, in your local church or in your congregation, whatever it is, you see a strange object and then you just pass. We don't do that because of the situation in which they were very vigilant, and immediately they didn't just gossip among themselves. Did you see those two spies? Did you see this? Immediately they went to the right source, the person that could actually control things, and they went to tell him. We should be security conscious so that if you see anything that is strange or anything that could be harmful, immediately, don't just take things for granted. Whatever saw this before, this is strange. You talk about it and then look at it in verse 3. And the king of Jericho said unto Rahab. The king of Jericho did not say, don't worry about that. What are your credentials there, by the way? You're telling me this, I want to know you. Get information immediately, quick. And then there's a good time to act when you have an information like that. And you act immediately. And the king acted immediately. That's what you'll be learning here. That if you have an information that, you know, there's a strange person, a strange object there, before they are there to do much evil in your church, your local church, in the congregation, or in the church at large, you report that. You know, you are hearing that that one has an evil spirit and is choosing his... you know, whatever it is, to manipulate people and destroy people and scatter people and destroy families. Well, I'm not going to allow them to hear that from me. Why not? And you hear that there's somebody that is, you know, doing a prostitution in your local church. And then she's like Jezebel, deceiving this and deceiving that. And, you know, the trusted men already, they are getting into, you know, this kind of thing. You know it. I'm not going to talk about that because you, they won't hear from you. Why not? They heard from these people. If you are for the protection of the church, the protection of the kingdom, the protection of the king, you're going to talk about that so that